This is GabNet, the Great American Broadcast Network. Talk radio like you've never heard it before.
Everybody, how are you? I'm Alex Bennett, and this is The Ramble, and it goes from now until midnight, Eastern Daylight Time. And if you're listening to us right now at about, 7 minutes past the hour on the East Coast, then you are listening to us, folks. You are listening to us alive. And if not, it's a recording, okay? So that's good, too. Anyway, where are we? Okay, let me explain a few things. Tonight, girlfriend is going to be with us. I'll tell you why in a minute, because it's kind of, it's kind of a funny story, I guess. I'll try and make it a funny story. We are presenting this in two flavors tonight on the Facebook page. If you look at the very top of the page, there is a thing that says the complete Ramble video. That means that from beginning to end, you will see a video, including the Citizens Panel. Okay, now on the other hand, right below that it says Alex Bennett's Ramble audio. Okay, now on that you can just jump in and watch, listen to the show as we go. Let me also put my camera on here so that we can. There we go. Now people can also see me on the audio. So up above video, you have to double click on that to get it bring up the video, and then on the right below that is the audio version of the show. Should you not want to see what the Citizen Panel looks like, so you have two different flavors tonight, and we'll see how that works. The reason why I'm doing the whole show from the beginning with just doing the video straightforward. We'll go to the Citizen Panel. You'll be able to see the Citizen Panel in a little while. Let me just show you what I mean. See, there's the empty screen waiting to be filled. And we're going to do that earlier than we normally do it because girlfriend is not with us tonight. And let me explain what happened to her. It's a tragedy. It's an absolute tragedy. She takes a lot of pills, okay? Her side, her whole side of her bed, the thing is almost a medicine cabinet full of every medicine you can possibly imagine, and then some. There are vitamins, there are her medicines, there are her blood pressure pills, all these different pills that she takes, and she takes them quite frequently, like every night. And in fact, once a month, she makes out the month's worth and puts them in these little glassine packages and stuff so that she has all the things that she's going to need for her drug habit, as it were. I mean, they're all medicines given to her by doctors and so on. But she also takes I think she takes an equal amount of vitamins, if not more, okay? And my feeling about vitamins is, to a certain extent, I believe in vitamins. But I don't believe in them to the extent that you take them like crazy. Because then all you have is expensive pee, all right? I have found a vitamin that works well for me, though. It's called a probiotic, but it's not really a vitamin. They call it a food supplement. But it has helped a great deal with my IBS. So I'm not going to say that these things don't work. It's just that I don't go 100% with them. But anyway, so she's got all these pills, right? And she knows pretty much one pill from another. And she decides she needed to take a pill for something tonight that was acting up, that wasn't one of her like regular pills. So she went into the drawer and she pulled out the thing, and then she takes the pill and she pops it in her mouth and she closes the thing and she looks at it and she goes, "I just took a Xanax." Yeah, she just took a Xanax. And she slept the rest of the night. That's all I'm saying. We're trying to watch TV shows. She's sleeping through them, okay? So anyway, she will not be with us tonight because she is passed out in the next room from having taken a Xanax when she shouldn't have taken a Xanax. She should have taken a Xanax when she goes to sleep. I sometimes see here. Look at me. I got this. These are my Xanax right here. Right. And if I don't have those, I do the, what's the other thing I do? I do one other. I do Lunesta. Just the name Lunesta makes you want to fall asleep, doesn't it? Anyway, so I welcome you all to the program without her. There's an empty seat over there. For those people who are watching on the video thing, I'll prove it to you because I can show you her empty chair. That would be filled by her if she wasn't passed out in the other room because she took a Xanax when she shouldn't have. People who are watching the TV version, the one that's going to have our panel, our citizens panel on it, you did not just see her empty chair, okay? I have two entirely different feeds going here, and this is it's all pretty amazing when you think about it. I am going to go to the phones quite early tonight, so everybody get ready to call. The reason is that I really don't have a lot to talk about. But last night I said something, and I really meant it. It was a thought that I had the other night. You know, when you're starting to go to sleep and you're starting to kind of fall off and go into la-la land, sometimes things hit you. And a very simple thought hit me the other night, and that thought was, why can't we, you know, we have a lot of goals in this country. Oh, we want to get people employed again, and we want to do blah, 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 and we want to stop foreign trade from coming over here, and we want to do this, and we want to build a wall to keep the Mexicans out and all. When is somebody going to say the only thing that we really would like to do is to make the United States paradise on earth? And make that our goal, and then do anything it takes to make this a paradise. Because, you know, here's the thing that really pisses me off. There's no reason it shouldn't be. There's no reason everybody in this country shouldn't have a wonderful life. And if they don't have a wonderful life because of illness or because of things like that, we at least make them comfortable, okay? But that all we care about is making each other happy. Now, there are countries in this world, I think Denmark's one of them, where that is actually happiness is their prime objective, happiness for everybody. Now, they've got problems with it. But, you know, if you set that as a goal, I think you're going to do okay, you know? You're going to do just fine. Why can't we make that a goal? What is so wrong with it? And of course, Phil came out and went, well, I don't think we should do that. I think that people aren't owed happiness. No, it's something you should want to give them because you're a nice person and they're a nice person and you want to give them something, you know? It's just the way we feel about people and about things and I don't know. I don't understand it completely, but I just wish we were of a mind to be able to be decent, okay? Be good and make each other feel good. Well, you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to open up the phones now, and if anybody wants to call, fine. A lot of people don't call this early because they don't think I'm going to be taking phone calls. And yet, here I am, I'm getting ready to take the phone calls. So why not give me a call right now? Our numbers, we have two different ways you can get a hold of us, okay? First way you can get a hold of us is by Skype. Skype is a phone system, kind of a video phone system, where we can see each other. And that's why we broadcast the citizen panel on Friday night, because you can see the people. And you go to Skype. .com, download Skype, install it, and then you simply give us a call at Gabnet Live, GABNETLIVE, because Gabnet, in fact, is the name of this network. And if you don't want to do that, you want to go the old-fashioned, we want to go old school, you can call us on the phone, which is 347-352-0079, 347 352-0079. Okay, so that's our that's the ways in which you can get in touch with us. Our lines are open in case you have just joined us, and it would be nice if some people called early, so I don't have to sit here and bellyache about stuff. I'm trying to think, was there anything newsworthy that just absolutely made me want to tell you something? And the answer is, I don't think so. I would like to think that everything is just fine. But anyway, I'm trying to think about it. Anything happened in the news? Hey, let me look at my phone. Where's my phone? My phone will always tell me. Because here's how I get my news these days. Simply pull down, and we look here. For instance, ethic filings show Ivanka Trump and Jared Kushner are worth as much as $741 million. Are you ready for that? Wait a minute. Hey, Jeff is calling. Let's say hello to Jeff, and we can actually transition over to the screen there. And there's Jeff. See him? Hi, hey, Jeff. Nice. How you doing?
Great.
You doing great?
Yeah.
Yeah. What do you think about Ivanka Trump and Jared Kushner making $741 million?
Oh, I didn't know that.
Yeah, yeah. You know, she's almost worth a third of what her father is. how are you feeling today?
And not $741 million worth.
Yeah, I bought. Let's see here. I don't know what I would do with $741 million. I'd take a vacation, and then I'd hire somebody else to run this place. Okay, that I could do that. That would be enough fuck you money to do that.
That's right.
Right.
That's for sure.
Yeah, and you know, but I mean, that kind of money is. I don't know. What do you think about my thing that I said about? Maybe we should make the goal of America happiness.
I heard you say that. Was it last night?
Yeah, I know it's it's Pollyannish and all of that, but you know we can't simply write it off. We should do something like that. You should make that a goal at least.
Well, I was always impressed. I worked with a couple of German companies,
mm-hmm.
and they used to come and visit us and yeah. work with us on projects.
Yeah.
You know, these are engineers, sometimes mm-hmm. the managers.
Yeah.
There. And we talk to them about how they operate.
Yeah.
And how their country runs. And it seems to me like one of the things that goes on there is if people lose their jobs
mm-hmm.
because of economy, because of technology.
Wait a minute, somebody turned, I think it's Kevin. Yeah, I think you just turned your audio up.
Yeah.
There. Okay. Kevin, also show us a picture, too, if you can. Are you there, Kevin?
Yeah.
Yeah, okay, good.
Okay.
Picture, too, right?
Yeah, but all we have is a still picture of you right now.
Okay.
Looks like I'm staring at Santa Claus a few months early. Yeah. Anyway, what were you saying, Jeff?
So they had a very social approach
mm-hmm.
about keeping work, and they tried to keep companies there running and bring in new business
mm-hmm.
and also if you were for one reason unable to do this kind of job because it didn't exist or whatever
mm-hmm.
for technology or whatever problem
yeah.
they would train you for the next job.
Oh.
And it was just like a you know a nice positive approach that the German try to take care of all the other Germans
by,
first.
By the way, say hello. Hello, Jason. Jason has joined us. Do you know, did you see this thing on 60 Minutes? This shows you the opposite of how we are, okay?
Yes.
Where companies were replacing workers with foreign workers, and the current workers weren't going to get their severance unless they trained the new workers to replace them?
Yeah, what company was that? I remember it was out here.
The one of them, and they this was on 60 Minutes. One of them was CBS.
Oh, jeez.
What about one of those? Was it Mitt Romney? He had a company that he bought out, and they are going to move it to China, and they actually took down the American flag, and I think hung a Chinese flag, and they brought some of the Chinese workers over to the factory to have them trained over here.
Yeah.
And then moved the factory over to China.
God. God. So, I mean, so that's what we do here. That's our, you know, that doesn't exactly instill happiness, I wouldn't say, you know.
That's capitalism.
That's capitalism for you. And it's terrible. It's horrible. You know, and I just don't know why we have money in this country, we have manpower, we have all these things. Why can't we just say, okay, starting tomorrow, we're all going to see what we can do to make this paradise on Earth? You know, and it can be nice. You know, it, maybe we can't achieve it totally, but at least we can get close. And even by getting closer somewhere there, we're going to be better than we are right now. Because what we are now is just a bunch of selfish fucks. Okay, I'm through. Thank you. I'm out of here. I'll drop the mic now. You know.
Boom.
Yeah, I should have a fake mic I drop all the time here.
There you go.
You know, but I mean, it's just, I don't understand it. You know, and that's, I don't understand, for instance, somebody like Phil, I don't understand his philosophy. I don't see how you can have that. Is there something wrong with me? Am I just not getting with the program? Is that what the problem is? Is all America so selfish that they want this, you know, this orange fuck we've got in office to ruin our way of life? Totally?
Well, he sure represents it, doesn't he?
Huh?
He sure represents what you're talking about, that's for sure.
Well, he doesn't represent a positive
no, that's what I'm
forward
saying.
Motion.
He's the corporate asshole that's you know,
yeah,
climbed the pyramid.
Well, he's gonna put oil in our water, and he's gonna do everything he possibly can to fuck up this country. And I think part of the reason is he's never actually lived in it. You know, he's lived in this cloistered world all his life of wealth and prosperity, and he's never had to deal with the real world out there. I mean, he probably didn't have to put up with smog in New York. He probably had filters in his building, you know? So
the servants came and cleaned the windowsills every day.
Yeah, yeah. Oh, I remember the windowsills. Do you remember the windowsills in New York?
Oh, yeah. They used to
in the old days?
Sure.
You could literally take your finger and rub it along a windowsill inside, and black gook would come off. It would get onto your finger. It was horrible.
Well, that was when they used to use a lot of coal.
Yep, yep. Which, well, he's more than happy to have us start using again.
That's right. Why not go back?
You know,
oh, sure. Because the worst thing in the world.
Well, people will go back to it because it will be the, I guess, the easier way of doing power. And they're going to be no law.
They will, though. Natural gas has come along so far that it's probably better for these plants for their own interests.
Well, maybe that's true. But the fact is that by getting rid of all these laws against the use of fossil fuels, you know, where are we going to be? We're going to be up to our ass in soot.
We just had a coal power plant. Was it just last summer? I don't know if it was even that long ago. The friggin' whole power plant caught on fire. You know, it destroyed it.
Oh, boy.
Yeah.
Jeez.
They already had a plan to switch over to natural gas, but, you know, it was before they switched over, somehow the coal caught on fire in the plant and just destroyed the whole place.
Let me just say to everybody who's listening two things. Number one, we're starting the calls earlier because girlfriend took a Xanax tonight by accident. she got way too many pills on that side. I have no idea. And also, if you're going to our Facebook page tonight, you have two flavors to watch this show in. You have the YouTube flavor, which is also being fed to the Facebook page, and that's on the top. And you have to click on that in order to get it to play. But it will play you'll see the citizens panel and everybody like that. The one on the bottom is what we normally run, which is basically just our audio feed without the picture of the citizens panel. So you have two ways to watch the program tonight. And on the one with just the audio, you can actually post things to people. So people can talk with each other on there. It has kind of a chat room going there as well. So I just thought people would like to know that.
that we're now servicing all kinds of flavors of program here. And the reason we're using YouTube for the video on Friday nights is that if you look at it, it's gorgeous. It is just gorgeous. So anyway, that's that. Hey, we haven't heard, you know, we hear from you about every other week, Jason, because your wife untethers you. And
she lets me out of the basement.
And allows you to crawl to your computer and Skype us. And so in the last couple of weeks, there must have been stuff you wanted to talk about. There must have been stuff that was just eating away at you.
You know, there is. And a lot of times it has to do something with Phil. And I almost want to call him and, or, you know, message him. But, you know, it's the next day anyway when I'm listening to the show. But I don't remember. You know, it's... I listen to you every day, though.
So, I mean, do you think we're up shit creek? I mean, am I being too pessimistic here? Tell me, I'm worrying too much.
I hope so, but you know, did you watch the TV show Fringe?
Fringe, years ago, yeah, kind of. Yeah. I stuck with it for about one season, I think.
Well, I had Leonard Nimoy on the end of it. There was like this parallel universe,
yeah.
You know, where Al Gore became president. And, you know, I feel like we just somehow walked into this parallel universe where it was possible for Donald Trump to become president.
Well, likewise, there may be another parallel universe where he isn't.
And that's where I feel like we should be, and somehow we just crossed over, or he crossed out of that parallel universe and took over the presidency.
Well,
I can't fathom it. I just don't understand how it ever became possible.
Maybe we should have the right of freedom to universe. In other words, I don't like this universe. I want to go over to the other one. Of course, in the other one, you know, you might be a beggar on the street. So, you know, you don't know what you are in the other universe. Gee.
Well.
Yeah. What are you going to say, Jeff?
I noticed that a lot of people that I see are all employed. And I wonder if everybody else has the same feeling. I mean, obviously, Al, you know, myself and you, Alex, we're a little older guys.
Yeah, it's not that I don't want a job. It's just that there's no way I can really get one.
I know. I know. But let's talk about people at Jason's age.
Yeah.
You know, are all of your friends employed?
Yeah, I don't know anybody who's looking for a job.
Okay, so, and how about, could you have said...
Hey, that's Donald Trump, he got employment.
Wait a minute, could you have said that about your friends 8 years ago, before Obama?
No, you know, people were losing jobs. I was scared I was going to lose my job. Mm-hmm. You know, luckily my company never really even took a hit through the whole recession. You know, we actually did really damn good.
Yeah.
But, you know, now I'm more scared just because technology's overtaken my job, but...
Technology's taken over in what way? That it's doing jobs, some of the job that you do?
No, more that, you know, I work in telecommunications and fiber optics has taken over. So when we built the Beast, put in the fiber optics, you ain't going to need hardly anybody to work on it anymore.
Doesn't it take maintenance?
Not really. You know, if something breaks, somebody has to fix it. But
so cables have to be... taken care of more than fiber.
Yeah, water gets into it, affects with copper, and you know, copper corrodes, and you know, glass, nothing happens to glass really unless it actually breaks.
Now, but you've got the fiber. Let me ask you this. You've got the fiber, okay, and that's what carries the signal. Is that fiber then encased in something?
Yeah.
So isn't that something? Can't it corrode or go bad, and then that part of the thing.
There's probably about five different insulators on it before you get to the outside of it. But one good thing is I heard that they're using peanut oil somehow to make the plastic that it's encased in, and squirrels love peanuts.
Oh, really? So the
nature takes over.
But with copper, you get a crack in something, water will find its way to the copper. You know, because you're running electricity.
Oh, I know. Do you ever remember with telephones, when you had a telephone at home, you could tell there was water in the lines because you got that squeaky sound, that crackly sound. And then when summer came, it went away.
Yeah.
And I would call up the phone company and say, come fix this, get rid of this. You know, I had it.
Called when it was dry out.
I had it in my cable. I had it in my cable where down in the basement.
I think they were feeding you a line of
shit. No, in the basement. No. Here's what happened. I'd be watching it and it keep flipping. Boom, boom, boom. And this went on for months. And I would call the cable company and they go, oh, well, it's probably something, you know. Here, unplug your cable and replug it in. I'm going.
Reboot it, yeah.
I've done that a billion times where you get somebody. They wouldn't get anybody out there. And finally, I just kept yelling and screaming and yelling and screaming and yelling and screaming. And finally, they send somebody over. This is the old apartment house. And they call me and they go, oh, there's water in the lines down there. There was a flood, and it's been that way for about 3 months. The only reason we did something about it is two other people complained, too. Apparently, it was only in my trunk. So if I was like eight, then everybody in eight or two or three people in eight would have to say something about it. Only one person says it, they don't pay attention to it. It was horrible. It was just terrible. That's when I learned what torrents were. You know, because I wanted to watch my TV shows without having them glitching on me all the time. And I felt I was paying for it. Fuck them, you know.
But yeah, you were talking about that with the torrents and, you know, Rob was saying that you shouldn't do it if you don't have a VPN.
Yeah.
Your cable provider can find out if you are doing torrents.
Yeah.
And they will kick you off of their network because it's illegal.
Well,
if unless the torrent site is somehow encrypting it.
Bingo.
So, and that, you know, but if you use the wrong torrent site or somehow they're discovered by your cable provider, they see that you, they'll usually send you a warning first, let you know, hey, you downloaded some.
Well, so far, knock on wood, all these years, I haven't gotten a single warning. And the outfit I'm now using says that there's no way that your cable, because what it does is all the stuff is encoded into RAR files to begin with. So it doesn't look like a video file.
Yeah.
So, you know, I mean, but, you know, I looked into VPN today.
But VPN is good, but it will slow you down, too, though.
Yeah. And, I'm doing this, so I don't, you know. And if they, you know, if they want to write me a note, they will, but they haven't. They, you know who they got once? Albert. They got Albert. He downloaded a movie. He downloaded what was the movie? It was a bad one. It was... Oh, boy, I can't even remember what it was. It was some horrible film. Just terrible. Something that would be a waste of time to download. But anyway, he downloaded it, and they wrote him a letter and said, if you don't stop downloading, we're going to take you off. And I never got one of those, ever. And other people I know who do torrents and stuff haven't gotten them either. I think the cable companies have kind of given up on it. They feel it's the job of the movie companies or the television companies to police that sort of thing and not the cable company's job.
So my mom called me and was asking me about the Fire Stick the other day. You know, you can have them either jailbroke or you have the certain app downloaded onto it where you can watch movies that are out in movie theaters now.
Mm-hmm.
She had no idea those are illegal.
What, Fire Sticks?
Yeah, the Fire Stick itself is not illegal, but when you have the sites where you're watching movies that are still in the movie theater.
Yeah.
You know, she didn't understand the whole concept of torrents and, you know, if that was illegal, then why can't you just download it on your cable provider and watch it at home? You know, it's funny. I wonder how many people are out there and don't realize half the stuff that they're doing is actually illegal.
Well, you know, to begin with, I never would ever download a movie. I think that's wrong. However, if I went to see the movie, what's so bad about it? I actually paid to see it. All right. But, I don't. TV, on the other hand, I do in some cases because I want to see certain things that I can't see.
You do?
Yeah. But, you know, I mean, I'm not going to admit to any of this. I don't download anything. Okay. I don't download torrents, nothing.
Allegedly.
But, you know, I mean, I think that you may say that I'm wrong about this, but I don't think so. I think it really is the job of the people providing these services to provide them at a cost that makes people not want to steal. You know, it was like there was a theory in the old days with, remember when people were stealing computer programs? And one company came out and started putting out cheap computer programs, good ones, you know. And they didn't have anybody stealing their product because people felt that for $15.95, they could own it and they felt good about that. But they wouldn't feel good about, you know, paying $300 for Microsoft Office as an example or something like that. So, you know, you've got to make these things priced so that people want to buy them.
It's all part of supply and demand. You have to have the right supply, right demand, and get that balance to where, you know, it's equaled out.
Well, on the video side, you know, I mean, Apple's been pretty reasonable. Apple had a program called Final Cut Pro, which is their video editing software. And I got to tell you, it's really good. You know, and the price was $300. Now you say, well, okay, that's a lot, but I paid for that. I paid for that a couple of years ago, about 4 years ago, and they keep upgrading it all the time, and I've never had to pay more than the original $300. Nice bargain. Tom, you've got a lot of noise there.
Yeah, I'm calling from the corner of Hastings and Castro.
Yeah.
And it's sort of breaking up right now, but we've just had a visual for Gilbert Baker, who died today.
Who?
Gilbert Baker is the man who designed the rainbow flag. He died in New York at age 65. And so Cleve Jones, who's known for designing the ace quilt, gathered us at Market and Castro. They put up a new rainbow flag, and then we just marched down to 18th and Castro. And as I said, it's sort of dissipating now, but it was a very, very moving ceremony.
Yeah. Well, how did he come about with the rainbow flag? I mean, why rainbow for gay, lesbian, transgender?
Well, actually, when he was talking, maybe I'll move to a place where it's a little bit quieter, as they said, on the street. Back in the late 70s, there were two main symbols for what was then known as gay liberation.
Yeah.
One of them was the lambda symbol that nobody understood, he said.
Yeah, I remember
and,
that symbol.
The other was the pink triangle, which actually came from the Nazis. And so they were trying to think of something that was more positive and inclusive.
Mm-hmm.
And Gilbert Baker thought of something that would be a symbol of diversity. And as he came up with the rainbow design, he didn't even know how to sew. He taught himself how to sew. Cleve Jones was saying that he was actually involved in the dyeing process for the cloth.
Yeah.
And so it was... something, and they were doing it for the Gay Pride and Civic Center in 1978. So that was the first time that the rainbow flag was unveiled, and it just was immediate success as soon as everyone saw it.
So he died, and he was 65, was he?
Yes.
Well,
yes,
he left. It would be nice if all of us could leave such a great legacy, you know?
Yes. I understand.
Anyway, let me cut the call short only because it's rather thin and it's a bit noisy.
Okay, well, I just wanted to call in and check in and let you know what was going on.
Okay.
And I'll talk to you again later.
And I'm glad you did.
All right, thanks.
Bye-bye. Okay, we've been joined, by the way, by Rob Alfano.
Hey there.
Wait a minute, why am I still getting a hiss? Who... You don't have a hiss there, do you, Rob? No.
Let me mute.
No, that's you're fine.
Maybe it's me. I got a fan going in the background. Let's see.
Yeah, that's you. If you could turn the fan
off. Okay, let me aim it away from the mic.
Yeah, yeah. Hello, by the way, Rob. How are you this evening?
Good. Calling you from my former studio. Oh, see, the equipment is still here, but nothing's wired.
You've done so much nice work in there.
Yeah.
I'm going to cry. You know, I feel like I'm losing a studio.
The equipment is still here, but there's not a wire to be had.
Yeah, yeah. And suppose the next people who move in go, you know what I really wish I could put in here is a studio.
That would be.
It sounds so different in here because my sound, I have three sound pads in the front and the curtains over here.
Yeah.
Now it's real noisy in here.
Oh, well, you know. Yeah, but I mean, you know, it's just these real estate people tell you what you got to do, right? They tell you got to do this and you can't do
that. When my realtor walked in here 2 weeks ago and the studio was still here, she said, "Well, I don't know what to do with this." She said, "What?" That's exactly what her words.
What is that?
She looked at it and said, "Well, I don't know what to do with this."
But it has a closet, right?
Huh?
It has a closet, right?
Oh, it's a bedroom. Yeah, it has a closet. The closet.
See, I guess I don't.
Double doors right there.
Maybe it's just because I've been so interested in, you know, in real estate that I look past furniture.
Well, no, it's not a matter. She said, you know, how do I market it, right? So, because they take pictures
It's another room you can make into a bedroom.
Right.
You know, use your imagination.
But the thing was it was so dark in here, right? It's like, well, a radio studio was
there.
You know, it was very dark in here. And when you take away that sound, the room sound, it's like very dead sounding in here. It's an odd sound. And if you're not used to it.
Well, maybe it's a place like I think like a child molester might like to get that place.
Spit out his cognac.
because it'd be a good place to have kind of as a dungeon, you know?
Well, usually dungeons are in the basement. This is on the top floor of the house, but okay.
Well, now we have another fan. Diane, do you have a fan on?
No.
Wait, mute yourself for a second.
You know, I'm trying to. I don't see. I only see like this little tiny oblong square. I don't know why I can't.
Have you ever gone you go. Into your preferences,
now,
Diane?
No, wait a minute. Did somebody just turn off their audio?
Diane, you told her to mute.
Diane, did you mute? Yeah,
yes, I did.
You're the one that has a fan, but we'll survive with it. Don't worry.
Oh, I'm sorry. You know, it must be my microphone, maybe. It's okay?
Yeah, it's fine. We'll live with it. We'll live with it.
Yeah.
We're working our way towards another full house here. We've had six straight days of full houses.
That was seven.
Was it seven?
I think it was seven last night, wasn't it?
Was it seven? Oh, yeah, it was seven last night. It was four the week before what?
I think it was 10.
You think it was 10. I see. Yeah. Phil's with us again tonight to, you know.
Bust your chops.
No, you don't bust my chops. I don't let you bust my chops.
Hey, any update on your store, Phil?
Yeah, it doesn't look good. It looks like it's another one falling through. So I'm going to list it with a broker.
Hey, I'll buy it from you.
All right. Okay. Yours. I'll trade you for GabNet.
Okay. You can have GabNet and I'll take your I don't know the first thing about rugs, but I could use one. So, you know.
What happens if you just close it, Phil?
I'd lose a lot of value. I mean, I could and I might down the road. Although you see, I've been trying to run it and not have employees. Maybe what I need to do is hire some salespeople, get it up and running to the point where I don't have to be there. And some customer service will fall because salespeople won't necessarily give my customers the same level of. Of expertise and attention that I want to give them.
Could you try to change it to the same model as, you know, the Empire people?
You mean in-house?
Yeah.
That takes a tremendous amount of advertising. And you know what? The Empire is starting to get their own brick and mortar locations.
They're
the most profitable. Empire is the most profitable model in the floor covering business. But they're doing their best to fuck that up.
How you say they're fucking it up?
Well, you know, they have enormous...
By the way, in case people don't know what we're talking about, are they everywhere in the country or are they just here in New York?
Yeah, I think they're everywhere.
Oh, really? Because they
I thought they were special out here, but I guess they're all over.
Well, no. When I was first here in New York, I think they existed.
Yeah. 300 and
No, it's a relatively newer thing. They didn't exist in New York originally. I think they started in Chicago. And
I seem to remember, Phil, when I first lived in New York.
And yeah, you remember Alan Carpet. You remember Kaufman's Carpet.
No, but I also remember these guys because they had the guy. Now he's a cartoon, but he was an actual guy back then.
Well, my father, our main account was Alan Carpet. They had 56 stores, and we did all the installations for them. And and they were based out of Inwood, Long Island. But right. That was Alan Carpet. The big competitors was Kaufman. And Kaufman had almost as many stores. But then you had all the department stores that were selling it, and there was some small independents. But for the most part, when you first moved out there, the carpet business was all stocking business. So Alan Carpet had a 1 million square foot warehouse in Inwood, Long Island, and they stocked millions of yards of carpet because that's the way the model was back then in the 70s and 60s. And then...
I remember going to carpet stores and there were miles and miles of carpet in huge rolls.
Right.
You could see when you would go in and look at the showroom, just tons and tons of rolls of carpet.
Right. Everything was there. It was in stock. You picked from what was there. It was almost like going to a car lot.
Right.
Now, do you guys have territories or no? Like, could I technically open a carpet one right next door to an existing carpet one?
You could if you if you slit the guy's throat, but we're co-op, and co-ops don't have territories like a franchise. But we're friendly, and the closest store to me I think is about 19 miles away.
Because that's what I was just thinking. You know, maybe to try to capitalize on just these other mom and pop carpet stores to try to get them all to become Carpet One, you know.
Oh, they've tried that, but the only ones that become Carpet Ones are the ones that have that are the largest presence in the area, that have the best credit, that give really good service. So you can't just do it. It's an extreme vetting process, just like Trump does with the
So anyway, let's get on to other stuff.
Jeff was asking.
Yes, Jeff.
I was just going to say that I used a broker in selling my company, and I was pretty happy.
Yeah, I have a buddy that.
But
just
you know
sold.
What you're going to have to do? You're going to have to clean up the studio and make it back into a regular room at your home. You realize that?
Yeah. No, I have a buddy that just sold a mega commercial laundry business. He had one in Santa Cruz, one in Reno, and one in the Valley somewhere. And they own the buildings. I mean, it was a major thing. And they do casinos and hospitals, millions and millions of pounds of laundry. And so he just used a broker to sell that. So he gave me the guy's name and says, "This guy will take care of you."
Yeah. Well, anyway. Let's see here. What other things are happening? I'm looking at my headlines today. There aren't many.
Well, there's a good one.
I have one, but go ahead, Rob. What do you have?
The one that says if what's his name wants a deal, I can't think of his name because I'm not looking at the news.
Flynn
wants a deal. Yeah. He's going to have to turn in Trump.
Yeah.
Oh, really? Oh,
drop dime, huh?
He wants immunity for something he didn't do, right?
He wants immunity. He's going to have to turn in Donald Trump. That's going to be the deal they want to make.
If they give him blanket immunity, he's just going to go and say, I did everything. It was all me.
May I please start sounding like Phil a little bit here for a second?
Conspiracy.
I find something wrong with that because that's like telling somebody, well, you tell us something that we want to know, and then we'll let we'll give you immunity. But what they want you to do is to drop a dime on somebody you might not be able to drop a dime on. So they're asking you to actually throw them to the wolves, okay, in order for you to get your immunity. And I think there's something a little wrong with that.
Well, I don't think I think that's a headline, but in the end what it might be is it will only accept a deal if you have information that leads to that. Now, if you don't, then good, you know. Now,
well, then why can't you? Why what are you afraid of in going before that committee and saying I don't know anything if you truly don't know anything?
He committed a crime. Flynn committed a crime. He did speak with Russian whatever it was, and based on that, he was in violation of something, and he wants to make sure that if he testifies, that he's not going to incriminate himself.
Yeah, well, but how is it a crime to talk to the Russians?
I think he did it.
Wasn't there money?
Got paid.
I'm not sure about
that.
He got
paid. Okay.
Got paid.
By the way, I've been joined by Brian. Hello, Brian.
Hello.
You don't have video tonight, right? You're on your phone?
That is correct.
Okay, but you sound good, so don't worry about it. Just jump in whenever you can. So Flynn has to decide whether he's going to drop a dime or not.
Well, Trump today said that he wants Flynn to testify, and there was nothing about the immunity. He just said he wants him to testify.
Yeah, didn't he say that if there's no crime, let him testify?
Yeah. Well, if there's no crime, let him testify. But if there is a crime, don't let him testify.
Not necessarily. I don't think there was any mention of crime. I think he just said, I want Flynn to testify. He wants to get these things out in the open.
Yeah.
Boy, there's a lot of controversy with this administration. Just like, what, 2 months
first
in?
First
100
days.
Isn't it 75 or 70 so far?
Yeah, well, then he's really ramped it up, because it usually takes him at least a year before they indict somebody.
Yeah. Well, now I'm reading these things, and of course they're on Facebook, that the people in the Obama administration actually did do this.
That's any less valid than InfoWars.
Yeah.
Wait, that it's like as if it were on InfoWars or Breitbart or Drudge, that it would be any more legitimate.
Well, I'm not saying that I know for a fact it's legitimate. I'm asking about the legitimacy of the story, and I'm throwing it out there that there were people in the Obama administration that actually, they say, did monitor Trump and so illegally.
Uh-huh. Yeah. We're one away, by the way, from 8 straight days of full houses.
Oh.
Huh? How about that?
Well, it's early.
I know it's early. And I think here we're going to get our, I see somebody coming online now that may be our 10th person. I mean, it's 10 with me is what it is. Yeah. If I go beyond the 9, we got problems. You know,
it counts.
Yeah. So anyway, here's one item that here we go. Here's Mark Green. Mark Green, congratulations! You have now made it another full house tonight. This is the eighth full house in 2 weeks. It's 2 solid weeks of full houses. And do you know what you get, Mark, for that?
No, I don't. I have no idea.
Nothing. Actually, we give you the booby prize. You get GabNet.
Actually, that's about what I expected.
So anyway, Senator Claire McCaskill busts GOP hopes, says she'll vote no on Neil Gorsuch and support a Democratic filibuster. So do you think Gorsuch is out?
No, there's 2 Democrats, Manchin and one other, that are going to vote for Gorsuch.
Hmm. But does that still make it enough people to pass?
Yeah. They've got 51 less 1 is 50, plus 2 Democrats is 52. And if it was a tie, they could always bring in Pence.
Yeah, yeah. I wonder how he'd vote. What?
I was just saying, just was watching YouTube, Jimmy Dore, the show, and he was saying that something like this happened before. People, in other words, don't let your hard-on get the better of you for, you know, them, for the Democrats, and sympathetic Republicans turning down Gorsuch, because if history's any indication, in the past, a similar turn of events occurred when a bunch of senators turned down the nomination of Reagan's first appointee, Robert Bork, and then which then metastamorphosized later when he had his second pick confirmed.
Yeah.
Scalia.
Okay. All right.
So who knows? We may get someone far worse than Gorsuch.
Well, you know, I mean, I hear where you're coming from. I think they were wrong to not give what's his name his day. I forget his name now. Merrick Garland, because Merrick Garland was so middle of the road that he would have been an easy fit and not.
Alex, the problem is he was appointed by a Negro.
Yes, you're right. You're right.
And an uppity Negro. Well, we can't have that.
Hey, let's face it. They don't come much more uppity than Barack Obama. I mean, what a pain in the ass he was, man. He was just on everybody's case, wasn't he?
I don't think Phil's quite right, though, on the numbers on the votes.
Yeah.
There's never been a Supreme Court justice that was approved with less than 60 votes.
Right, but
That's never happened before.
They're going to do what's called the nuclear option, and yeah, that
you
is
you don't know that you don't know that. Right
also there. Known as the nuclear option.
Yeah, okay. Nuclear option. Yeah.
That doesn't bite you in the ass 8 years from now. Do a nuclear option.
Hey, it may bite them in the ass 4 years from now, but you know, it looks like that's what they're going to do if there's a filibuster or they can't get the votes.
Well, yeah.
According to an interview I heard on CNN. The whole nuclear option was the Democrats doing, you know, that's where they take it from the Democratic playbook.
Yeah.
So
I'll tell you what that was, Rob. It was when Obama was president, the Republicans just blockaded all of Obama's choices to be district court judges, not Supreme Court. And so finally, Harry Reid got so frustrated that he said, okay, forget the 60, 51's enough. And so now they're gonna take that and make that, you know, the precedent for the Supreme Court, which I guess you can argue, you know, but yeah. that's how that happened. But in either case.
We just keep changing the rules.
Yeah.
The constitutionalists should be against that, shouldn't they?
Yeah, you still think we don't need term limits there, Mr. Bennett?
We don't need term limits. Well, what I was arguing about was basically congressmen, who are the ones who their job is to bring back pork, okay? To bring back stuff to you, the local place, you know, and for you to get. You know, pork and schools and things like that. And if you have somebody in there who is not particularly, what can I call it? Not particularly an expert on this sort of thing, you don't have a good representation in Washington. That's my only argument for people serving more than one term. Senators, I'd say one term, that's it. You're in, you're out, you know. But congressmen have a slightly different function. Yes, Jason.
You know, I am against term limits because, you know, that you're restricting my right to vote for who I want to vote for when you're implementing term limits. And then you're also giving historical memory. You're taking that away from the people who are in the representative.
Yeah.
And well, giving that to lobbyists.
You're kind of saying
lobbyists aren't going to have term limits.
You're kind of saying what I was saying in a way, is that you want an experienced person there. The thing is that you can say, I want term limits because I don't like these people being able to stay in there forever, and they do terrible things by staying in there forever. There's people who've been in there forever who've been terrific. Okay.
How about corruption? Huh? Who's been terrific? You know, you got people, both Republicans and Democrats, that have been there.
Okay. You want me to tell you somebody who isn't corrupt, who I don't like?
Yeah.
Schumer. Schumer's not corrupt in any way, shape, or form.
Find it out and vote him out.
What?
Don't say he has his own agenda, because everybody has an agenda.
No, he has his own agenda. That's why I like his politics.
How about his agenda being to represent the people that sent them there?
But he does. Absolutely, he does. He votes the conscience of his New York constituency.
If you're going to say that, Phil, then you need to talk about your Republican cronies who want to vote out Obamacare when more than 50% of the country wants it. So who are they representing?
I have no problem with getting rid of the Republicans and the Democrats as one-termers only. I'd give them a little longer term. Let them do their thing and let them get the fuck out, because
you're going to put the power in the lobbyist's hands if you do that.
I didn't say the lobbyists get a pass either.
I don't want lobbyists either.
They don't get a pass either. Get them the fuck out of there too.
Oh yeah, arrest those motherfuckers. You know.
Let me just
your business out of my government.
Let me answer. Mention something, Tony. Quit calling. We have a full house. We can't accommodate you. He probably isn't even listening to the show. You know.
Yeah, I'll send him an instant message.
Send him an instant message and tell him to, because he'll keep calling and calling, and it's TV night, and it keep coming up on the TV screen, and you know, it's a pain in the ass. Anyway,
the problems of first world country problems, right? You got a full house every night.
Yeah, right.
May I interject, because I can't stay on too long.
Oh, this is Steve, and he just had an operation today.
Yeah.
Congratulations, you made it, Steve.
I did. I woke up alive, and I was glad. And things, just not to get into details, things went quite well. Mm-hmm. Things look pretty good, but I have a road to travel, you know, and it's going to be, I'll make it. I did it last year. I could do it again this year. So,
okay.
But I just wanted to tell, you know, how much I enjoy listening to it. Call and listen. Yeah, I need the diversion. I need the distraction. So,
yeah.
You know, it's really good. And I also just wanted to just check in, because yeah, and I really appreciate the callers last night on your show and Jack's. You know, it was really nice, and I at least wanted to just say hi for now.
Okay, all right, and we'll talk to you when you're able to get to a phone and spend more time with us. Okay.
Okay. Good luck on your Tuesday.
And good luck on your recovery.
I appreciate it.
Okay.
Thanks, everybody.
Bye bye. Yeah. Okay, you can now write Tony and tell him
Yay, Tony!
Yay, Tony!
I noticed we finally have a woman on the panel. Thank you.
Yes, we don't know what happened.
Breath of fresh air.
We don't know what's happened
to
breath of fresh air.
Yeah, we don't know what's happened to what's her name?
Renee.
I mean, she. I know she. Every now and then, she writes on the chat room and things like that, but she just doesn't call anymore. So, you know. Okay.
What is your name? Sorry.
Me? Are you talking?
Oh, her name is Diane. Diane Week.
Yeah, Diane.
Okay.
I listened all the
nurse,
time.
Right?
And we now have Tony on with us, the guy who never turns on his camera. I always have to remind him. Tony, I'm going to get rid of you. I'll tell you why. I'm going to get rid of you because I have somebody else calling who doesn't call in a long time. Let me add Mark, okay? Because I would much rather make room for Mark, who never calls, than Tony, who calls all the time and then doesn't say a word. Hello, Mark.
Hello, Alex.
Give me some video so we can see you. There's old Mark.
Video's on.
Really?
Yeah.
We have is the please stand by.
Oh my God! What happened? Skype changed.
I think sometimes when it's the four hats and there's like nine or eight, sometimes the last guy or two can't get his camera on.
No, I
bet you if I cut out, his camera would go on.
No, somebody just cut out. Jason cut himself out.
And my camera went away.
Your camera went away?
Yeah, so yeah, eight is it for the most part.
No, it isn't. No, it isn't. Every other night
we're gonna hang up and call right back.
Okay. Every other night we have not had this problem. Okay. So, you know, we've not had this problem. Are you still there, Mark?
Hold on.
If you get, oh, there we go. Now it's there we go.
And well, once
we bring Jason in. Jason, turn your camera on. Can you do that?
Yeah, I did before it picked up, and then my thing went away again.
Right.
Did Mark's come on?
Yeah, Mark's is on now.
He's a widescreen.
Yeah, I told you this. This has happened to you before, but you just forgot.
No, it didn't happen last night. For 2 weeks, we've had full houses, and this hasn't happened once.
But I got a big enough of a mouth if I want to speak.
First time for everything.
Yeah. You might try one more time hanging up and calling right, again, well, Jason. Just try that. We'll see what happens. But okay. Hi, how you doing, Mark? It's been a while.
Yeah, it's been a while.
Yeah, how you doing?
Hanging in there.
Wait, you sound exasperated.
Yeah, well, yeah. Gee, what else is new?
Yeah.
Can you blame them?
Yeah, it's the same old crap, different day.
Hey, Mark.
Jason's back with us. Jason, have you got a camera?
Yeah, no, my camera went away.
Wow, that's amazing.
Mark, I was reading an article.
Well, just yell. Just say Jason when you want to say something.
I got a big enough mouth.
Yeah.
I was reading an article, Mark, that Naples, Florida is the best, most relaxed place to live in the country.
Well, look at him. He looks exhausted.
It has also has the happiest people. Is that true? Come right.
I don't know. I'll be honest. You know, I'm like, really? You know, it's like, who the hell wrote this?
Well, you know, the saying goes, familiarity breeds contempt. I mean, people say good things about Pittsburgh in terms of its cost of living, but I've run into my fair share of miserable people too. So,
yeah. They're everywhere.
Yeah, they should be. Well, the other thing is, okay, were they down here during season when we have all the snowbirds?
Mm-hmm.
That's the other. And now it's gotten to the point where go home, snowbirds. You've worn out your welcome.
Yeah, yeah.
What's the worst thing about the snowbirds, Mark?
Too many of them.
You see a 4'11" Jewish guy who can't see over the steering wheel of his 1968 Cadillac. that's common.
Driving 30 miles an hour.
They're sitting on phone books.
Make it more like an 8990 caddy, and you got the idea.
Well, quit making fun of those people, Phil, because you're about to join them.
Yeah, I hope so.
Yeah, you're not that tall.
Nah, you know. So I got adjustable seats.
So you just shrink a little bit, you know. I mean, I haven't been behind the wheel of a car in maybe 2 years now, and I would. It might be if I get behind the wheel of a car, I'll have to have a phone book. I don't know, you know.
I think if you get behind the wheel of a car, you'll have to have a mortician.
Shut the fuck up, Jason. I'm glad I can't see you, okay?
Well, he's giving you the finger right now.
Is he really?
Yeah.
Yeah. There's his whole family sitting there on the couch giving me the finger. How did that happen?
Okay. Even the dog did it.
What did I say? What was I saying to Bubs the other day that, you know, I'm getting to the point where I don't really care what's going on because at my age, who knows how long I'm going to live, and I may die before this thing hits critical mass.
Your wife is a smart woman there, Mr. Bennett. She's right with her argument. You both are of that age where you, and I envy you for that, as a matter of fact. I envy actually a lot of older people on account of that. They don't have much to give a shit about anymore, whereas sure. I have to deal with this shit. Assuming, of course, we're not all living in fallout shelters in the next 10 years because of this cocksucker in the White House, that you don't have much of this shit to have to worry about much.
Yeah, so. I got one for you.
You got one what for me? What's that?
Well, it's an air raid siren.
What for?
Yeah.
Oh, he says we're going to be living in fallout shelters.
Oh, well,
don't
say anything, anybody, that makes him use a sound effect, okay?
Yes.
I don't even know what the name of it is, so you should.
Protective Life.
Wait a minute. Who was talking?
Mark.
Yes, Mark.
That's my wife, Becky. She's over in the corner.
Oh, okay. I was just wondering. I hear, all of a sudden, I hear this voice, and I'm going, well, it's not Diane.
No.
No. They heard the air raid siren and said, we better protect
life. Yeah, she was afraid we were being attacked.
Yeah. So, I mean, in a way, I feel like, well, so what? You know, I mean, with my luck, I'll live to be 100 and I will have to suffer all of this. And the worst part about it is with no life, without no safety net, because Trump will have removed all of them.
Yeah. Giving them to himself and his extended family.
Yeah. But it's bizarre. Jeff, as a person closest to my age on this panel, don't you feel this is about the weirdest thing you've ever seen in politics in your lifetime?
Absolutely. I've heard a couple of strange ones. Nixon was kind of...
Something? Just when you think you got the bad one, like Nixon, after a while, he turns out to be okay?
Yeah.
I'd take Nixon back in a heartbeat at this point.
Isn't that one of Murphy's laws? One of Murphy's laws where, you say, how could it get any worse? And lo and behold, it can.
It can. Well, I mean, it got worse with Bush than Nixon, okay?
Yep.
And that now it's worse than Bush. I mean, I would want Bush back now.
Now we miss Bush.
Yeah, yeah.
So when Lucifer takes control of the United States in about 16 years after the next Democratic president takes off after Trump, when Lucifer ascends to the throne of the White House, we'll be wishing for Trump again.
I'll tell you, here's the problem we have. And then Rob wanted to say something, but let me just say something while it's still in my head here. And that is that you can bet, we're living in a day and age where you can bet that once a Republican administration comes up for re-election, a Democratic administration will be brought in. And then once a Democratic administration is in there for a while, a Republican will come in. It's like it bounces back and forth because the American public is never happy.
The next one will be a Whig or a Tory.
Well, now, what were you going to say, Rob?
I think that's actually sort of a good thing because that keeps you sort of in the middle ground, right? You don't ever go too far one way or too far the other way, not a horrible thing.
But we've gone a long way, far way to the other direction with this guy.
Well, it's only been 100 days, and none of the things that he's wanted to do have really been approved yet. So, he wants to go and do all this defense spending and cut the EPA and cut everything else. That hasn't been approved. He can sign all the executive orders he has. We haven't really moved as far as we think we've moved.
Yeah, no, none. In fact, none of his stuff has really gone through, has it?
Well, he's signed a couple of things. He got rid of the transgender bathroom.
No, that was North Carolina and a judge.
No. But Trump was the one who said, "Give it back to the states."
Oh,
and that's
okay.
What let North Carolina do it.
Oh, okay. All right. Okay.
So, but for the most part,
Well, I love it how the Republicans are for states' rights on everything except something they don't agree with.
Yep.
do you ever notice that?
The music factory.
They'd like to go in and bust, stop Colorado from selling pot, right? Yep. And then they'll turn around the next minute and say, states' rights. We've got excuse me, I'm going to sneeze. You guys talk.
I tried to make sure it doesn't.
One thing that I'm kind of curious about, because on Monday I'm going to Mexico for vacation.
Yeah.
And so I'm wondering how, the environment is going to be, how are they going to, is it going to be Trump down there too? And, why are you down here? I thought you guys hate us.
Where in Mexico are you,
Jason?
Cozumel.
Jason, how are you going to get back?
Yeah, that's what I'm kind of worried about too. When I go down there, being half Mexican, I'll be tanned by the time I come back. They might say, you're not welcome back here anymore.
Diane, turn off your microphone a second. Let me just did you cut it? Yeah? Okay, you're not where the
Somebody
noise
else.
Is coming from.
Yeah.
Brian, cut your mic a second.
Hold on a second.
Yeah, you're the one where the fan is coming from.
He could be driving.
Yeah, are you driving, Brian? Brian, now he can't hear me.
Yeah, turn it off.
I had the engine running, so I turned it off.
Oh, okay. Where were you in the garage and trying to commit suicide? I mean, what?
give me about four more years. If this gets any worse, I may be now it's too early to tell.
Yeah, well, the Trump administration, as a service to all of the people who are so depressed about him, is passing out hoses.
Permanent retirement. You
know. I don't think he's going to make it past August. That's my prediction.
I do have a question. The whole argument of why it would be good, why it's good that we have oscillating political parties taking charge every election cycle.
Yeah.
Like Rob. As I respect his opinions, an intelligent guy, but the thing is, my analogy is this: you like riding. Say you like riding in the Twilight Zone ride at the Disneyland theme park, where it takes you up 50 stories and it drops you off real suddenly 50 stories. You know, you have your spleen for lunch. But I mean, that's funny. That's fun to do. That's fun to do, like once or twice.
Yeah.
But if you're doing that every time. Going back and getting that done, that does a wear and tear job on your psyche. That does a wear and tear job on your physiology.
Yeah, but don't you think that that's magnified when you got a guy like Trump in there? That in the past we've had Democrats, we've had Republicans, and you go, oh, I didn't vote for that guy, but all right, we're gonna get through it. And
I ultimately blame the American people for this, because of what Alex said. They're just too fucking impatient to just stay the course.
I didn't vote for him.
We want it now. Build it better, faster, cheaper, and we want it built yesterday.
Well, let me ask you this:
I felt the country was going in the wrong direction under Obama, and so did a lot of other people, and that's why they voted for Trump.
Look at our economy; it's not going in the wrong direction.
It's not just the economy; it was the
jobs. Look at jobs. We're basically
the society in general.
What
bothers you about this society, Phil?
The fact that I can get married.
We were turning people into weaklings. We were creating a society that depended on government for stipends rather than building.
That's bullshit. Because at the beginning of Obama's term, we did not have full employment. Now, after when he left office, we have full employment.
What we have is
it's less dependency.
Jason, what we have is a lot of $9 an hour people, and then we have a lot of people.
All right, $9 an hour people still qualify for food stamps.
Yeah, that's the problem. You don't necessarily want them to have to qualify for food stamps.
You should be in favor for raising the minimum wage.
No, you don't need to raise the minimum wage. If you create an economy that's thriving, then you compete for higher paying jobs.
Higher paying jobs?
Before we had a minimum wage?
A minimum wage should be for kids working at McDonald's. It shouldn't be for adults trying to build up a family.
But Phil, the problem is not that the problem today is that you can't open a business anymore. Every community, because of all these large companies that have taken over, the Walmarts, the Kmarts, the Home Depots, the Targets. You can't open a small store anymore and make a living. For your family. Now you're stuck going to work at $9 an hour at one of those places.
You can under the co-op version of businesses, and that's what I do. I belong to a co-op. And co-ops.
How many co-ops are there besides the carpenter?
Oh, there's a lot. Do you know that True Value Hardware is a co-op? Ace Hardware is a co-op. Carpet One is a co-op.
And the majority of the people who I've known who've owned these hardware stores that are part of the co-op, they run as soon as they can get out of them because they're being overcharged for all their product.
Yeah.
Well, no, they buy product directly from the manufacturer. And
the co-op does, but the store buys it from the co-op.
No, they don't. That's a franchise, not a co-op.
You can argue the minutiae of all of this, but big business getting into government is what caused this. Big business getting into government and setting up laws that protect them and are for them killed the little guy.
Well, everything has a pendulum, and everything always swings both ways. Now, it may not be swinging in the way of the small businessman right now, but with God willing, with Trump in office, I believe that the pendulum will start swinging.
I disagree. I don't think he gives a damn about the little guy. All he did was put billionaires in place. That's all he did. Everybody in his cabinet are billionaires. Right. So far removed from anything, knowing anything about what the common man's problems are.
These guys know how to clean the swamp because they were the swamp.
Clean the swamp.
Let me just say something. Tim, Tim's been trying to call in. Tim, we can't take your call because we have a full house. That's why I guess now in this day and age, you have to get in early. Like Jeff, who was our first caller tonight.
Isn't that nice?
You only have nine.
Huh?
You only have nine.
Really? No, I have my, so with myself, it's 10. You know. So, no, it can only be 10. Nine.
I don't see me, so I'm not counting me.
Oh, yeah, well. I'm wondering if we don't have video on you, somebody else could call in and have video. I don't
know.
No, what would happen is we would all blank
everybody
out.
Everybody loses video.
It would all revert to audio.
Yeah.
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 You want me to tell Tony to call so you can see if that happens?
No, I don't want to know. No,
but the one thing I'm wondering if, I'm sorry, I forgot your name, starts with a B, right, on the phone?
Oh, it's Brian. Alex.
Brian, if Brian hung up and called back because he doesn't have video, if that might actually bring my video on.
That would work.
That might work.
Brian?
To my computer.
Why don't you try hanging up?
Just hang up and call right
and
back.
And then call right back, okay?
And this way, you'll be able to try the video.
May get a camera thing.
Did you hear us, Brian?
Yeah, I'll try it right now.
Okay. Okay. In fact, yeah. Okay. He just hung up. Now try your have a camera, Jason.
Wait. Now I think maybe when his icon goes away, it might pop up. There it goes.
Okay. Is it there? Okay. There. Now I'll add him.
Yay! Okay. You know.
Okay. Hey, and then I added Brian, and here's Brian back again, and we have Jason's picture.
Oh wow! Yeah.
He was holding a video. He was holding a video spot, and he couldn't use it.
Oh, I see.
Right. Cause it was like a little red thing there, like something that went away, the little red.
So, Mark, in all the time, I'll ask you what I asked Jason earlier, in all the time that we haven't heard from you, which has been many weeks, maybe a month or so, is there anything that you wanted to get on here at one time and just yell about, but you couldn't get to a Skype line or anything?
Gosh, hard to remember anything now.
These things. Oh, no, I said Mark.
Oh, sorry.
Mark.
I'll defer to Diane.
What'd you say?
No, I'll defer to Diane, see if she...
I meant Mark with a C. Excuse me.
Oh, I'm like, oh, me? God, Alex, plenty. I mean, I'm, jeez, I just don't want to raise my blood pressure to the point where I get a heart attack.
That would be a first for our program. That would be
You don't want that.
You know, people are using Facebook to rape people. So I figure, you know, Facebook
really?
Live. Yeah, there are people doing rapes on Facebook Live. And
get the fuck out of here.
Yeah. No, I'm telling you the truth.
I don't believe you.
It's amazing how people are that weak-willed and jelly-spined that they allow themselves to be subjugated to such inane methods of intimidation and bullying.
It's greed.
No, but what do you mean greed? It has nothing to do with greed. It has to do with people using Facebook Live to rape somebody and put it on video.
Oh, you mean to say that they're broadcasting?
Yes.
There's cyberbullying too.
There was a case, and didn't the person get prosecuted or something?
No, because Facebook Live is just a few months old.
It was on one of the
One of the others. Yeah, I mean, there was other social media in which they ran a video of a rape or whatever. But this is Facebook Live where they were doing.
It's a 14-year-old girl, and it was just the other day, and I think it was a 17-year-old boy, and the other day, and it was Facebook.
Oh, okay.
Everybody wants to be a star.
Diane, what'd you say?
I said, like, it's the sick need for wanting to be a celebrity, you know, the celebrity society, you know, to be the center of attention.
All they have to do is call
you. Do anything, you know. Yeah. And, you know, almost, it sounds like it could be hopefully staged, you
by,
know.
By the way, Phil just gets an award because that's his, I think, 10th negative reference to Gabnet this week. I don't know. I just want a place where people can be happy. You know, I never thought I would become Pollyanna, but I really believe that we have the ability, or maybe we don't have the moral ability.
Ooh.
What is that?
It's got the vibrator working.
Alex, you said you want a place where everybody can be happy. I think the only place that's going to happen is at the morgue.
Well,
nobody, there's a positive thought.
Yeah. Hi, everybody. Welcome to the Alex Bennett Ramble. We're here every night to depress you.
You got to lay on a slab, and then you'll be happy.
Yeah. Yes, Diane.
Yeah, I mean, wasn't this country founded on the idea of pursuit of happiness? Mm-hmm. I mean,
pursuit.
Yeah.
Everybody's guaranteed.
At least that was that's where people came here to find happiness, to find
life, liberty,
you know,
and
liberty, and pursuit. But you know, still, it was a goal. It's a goal.
Oh, absolutely.
It's a movie, Will Smith.
Yeah. And actually, it doesn't say that in the Constitution. It says "perfuit of happiness."
Ah, yes.
Yeah.
The guy had a lisp.
Yeah.
I did have an issue. I'm sorry.
I just looked at my little pad here, and I have a word written on it. And
so it's that time of the month.
No. Let me tell you what the word is. Explain it to you. Today I was doing my movie reviews with Michael Snyder. I don't know if you ever listened to them, but they're there. You know. Anyway. And he's talking about some animated film. He said, taken from a manga. And I told him that if I asked the 9 people on my panel, maybe only one would know what a manga is.
I don't.
Mark, you know what a manga is?
Manga.
Manga?
First off, I think it's pronounced manga. I could be wrong. Yeah, it's
manga. Well, wait a minute. Don't say it yet.
Yeah.
For the rest of you, do you know what a manga is?
No,
anybody?
Know.
Diane.
I've
Rob,
heard of it and I can't think of it.
Mark. Jason, you're the youngest one around here tonight, I think.
Nope.
Kevin, you look like a hip guy.
A mango?
A manga.
Manga, no. Mango's a fruit.
And I tried to tell him, if you're going to use a word like that, explain it. Because I never heard of the term in my life. And he went, you've never heard of this term? How unhip are you that you haven't heard of this term? The only person here who I suspect knows what a manga is because he's into that kind of stuff is Mark. Mark, what is
Tony
a manga?
Tony would have known.
Tony would have, yeah. It's a Japanese comic book.
It's Japanese graphic novel.
Yeah, sequential art, yeah.
Yeah.
And it was something oriental.
And I tried to tell him that nobody would know what manga was. You know, you have to explain these things. I said, you know, would you, in normal conversation with somebody, Mark, use the term manga?
No.
Because
they knew it, you know.
Yeah, I mean, if you went to a...
Luckily, the kids I work with know exactly, you know, what I'm... you know, they're into it more than I am. So it's like, okay.
It's like acronyms. There's so many damn acronyms now.
Acronyms.
I mean, acronyms.
Yeah.
You're constantly sitting there listening to people talking about PIVs and XYZs and
LMNOPs.
Like shop talk.
IDGAF.
Yeah. Let me
ask this question, because we were talking about my whole perfuit of happiness thing. And I'd like to know from each of you, what do you think would make this country happier? What kind of thing that we could do for the country as a whole would make it happier? Kevin, do you have an answer to that, or anybody?
Equality.
Huh?
Equality.
Equality in what way?
Get you know, level everything out again. You know, not have so much poverty on one side and so much richness on the other side.
In other words, even the society.
Equalize everything. Yeah.
How do we go about that, though?
God only knows. Not the way it is now. It'd take years to even figure it out.
Yeah, because we do live in an age where we have a whole bunch of people. We actually have oligarchs in this country
now. It brings up something that I was thinking about when you were talking about the Republicans and the Democrats.
Yeah.
Why are there just Republicans and Democrats? Why don't these independents or whatever ever get in there and try and stir the shit up?
Because they
get knocked out by the Republicans and the Democrats.
I bet Mark has an answer for you.
No, I don't.
You don't?
That's a damn good, you know, again.
Okay, wait a minute. Brian thinks he has an answer. I have an answer too, but Brian?
Let's see if it coincides with yours, Mr. Bennett. Three words. Winner take all.
Yeah. Greed.
Money, 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 money.
Switch to a parliamentary system where there's more than one party and, you know, the leading party is able to get their shit pushed through.
Let me ask you this, okay? Here we go. A big commie question of the night. Could it be that what stands between us and a happier society is capitalism?
I don't think so.
No,
I think it goes deeper than that. I think what stands between us and a happy society is us.
I think another way people would be happy is if they had faith and trust again in their government.
Yep.
I think ever since Nixon, we have been on a spiral down with trusting anybody who is in power. And I think that has soured people on the United States and our entire institution. Mm-hmm. And I remember being very prideful in the 60s. You were so proud to be an American. I think today, most of that is rhetoric. I think most of that is all fake bullshit, all that
Ben
pride.
And you were too young to remember the mistrust of Johnson and the fact that he was bombing Vietnam and how the kids took to the streets and basically hated that guy.
I don't remember, as a person who was against the war in Vietnam, hating Johnson. I just felt that he was incapable of handling it. I think that was the problem that he had, and
he admitted that.
Would you not agree with that, Mark?
Yeah.
He was over his head.
Yeah.
And he admitted that, too.
Yeah, and that's why he didn't run again.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, he did a lot of good, too.
He couldn't
Civil
get
a right.
That's why he didn't
He
run.
Was maybe, if you go back and you look at all the presidents we've had for the last, going back to the Truman and then going onward, I think Johnson was probably the best president of them all.
Why? Because he continued Kennedy's agenda? It wasn't his agenda.
I'm not. Who cares if he was doing somebody else's agenda? He got it done, Phil.
He
got it done. And I think he happened to be a very good president. I think his big fault was that because he was a man of the soil, the man of America, he didn't understand foreign politics very well, and that's why he didn't do well in his decisions about Vietnam.
Was he a senator or a congressman?
He was a senator, I believe.
Well, I understood that he was one of the most powerful people in the Senate, and I think he knew plenty about how to get it done politically. I just think that...
No, I'm saying this to you. You didn't listen to me. And it's always been said about Lyndon Johnson is that he was a man of the United States. He didn't have an international bearing. And so therefore, he didn't understand international politics that well and was not that adept at it. The same thing was true of Kennedy. Kennedy was very good with foreign policy because he understood foreign countries. He didn't understand America that much because he was too cloistered. Yes, Mark.
Yeah, I think he got more done than any president that I can think of.
Yeah.
I mean, he was a man of the South who got the civil rights legislation passed.
Yeah. So what do you think would have happened if his Congress was like Congress today?
Well, I don't know.
He also passed
Medicare.
He wouldn't have let it happen.
Yeah.
Harry Truman at the signing ceremony saying, This is what will prevent senior citizens from having to beg for charity. And all the Republicans were against him. Imagine the world today if senior citizens had didn't have Medicare.
Right. And that
tell me something more significant.
That was a signature legislation. Exactly. You know, but I'll give you more significant legislation. Some of the civil rights legislation was outstanding and is with us to this very day. You know, he was, and what he was, he wouldn't have had the same problem with Congress that Obama had. He wouldn't have had the same problem that Trump is having.
You really believe that? You don't think that it's the people now?
No. I'm saying that divisiveness. If you go back and you look at him, this was a guy who'd been in the Congress for so long that he knew how to hustle those people. He knew how to bring them into the office and say, "Listen, you son of a bitch, here's what you're going to do." And he would lay the law down, and the guy would leave shaking, you know, and go pass his bill.
That HBO special was that they did on him was awesome. I can't remember the name.
It really points out what a powerhouse he was, you know, and what a political animal he was. Kennedy could have never gotten all that stuff passed because he didn't.
And I think he knew what he believed. You know, he fought for what he believed.
Yeah.
Donald Trump, I don't know that Donald Trump believes in anything.
Oh, I don't think he does.
I agree with you.
I don't think he does either.
Yeah. You
know, he walked away from that.
He believes in Donald Trump. That's it.
Yeah.
If
I was going to throw out an idea how to make the world better, I would cut our defense budget by 4/5.
I agree with you.
Well, and maybe we don't hang our hat on just being the biggest tough guy on the block.
Well, also, we're living in a different age where we don't need the troops on the ground like we used to in the kind of numbers we used to. And we can run a more technological war. But no, we're going back to building the bombs and building basically an obsolete army, an obsolete force.
An army of special forces.
An army of special forces might work, you know, for certain things. But tell me, you know, drones can do a lot, you know, and technology. I mean, people are fighting wars with us on the internet, and we don't have that same power.
We need to develop our educational system so we have smarter people.
Well, because we have a bunch of old farts running this country now, and Trump is an old fart, right? Mm-hmm. Who can't see that you have to run? There's a new kind of war being waged out there, and he doesn't know how to fight it. He just thinks you throw more people and materials at it.
Drop a bomb on him.
Yeah, yeah.
Well, Jason lives pretty close to Canada. What's the difference between us and Canada?
Man, people in Canada are nice though.
Well, they're not looking to rule the world, you know.
No.
They're not looking to
why do we need to be number one? I guess that's I've asked myself that for years.
Well, yeah. Number one in military.
Well, I always hate this chant, we're number one. We're number one. USA, USA. I mean, come on, this isn't a fucking football game. You know, this is real life. And
it's nationalism.
And nationalism sucks. Nationalism is corrosive.
Nationalism is without having to butt your nose in everybody else's business.
Nationalism is what brought Hitler to power. Yes, Diane.
Didn't it come down? Am I going to have this right? The Marshall Plan, I think it was called, expanding our influence throughout the world and, you know, being the, you know, policing the world. I think that's what the Marshall Plan was, but I may be wrong. But I know there was a policy that for us to expand and throughout the world and, you know, our influence.
I thought the Marshall Plan was a set of policies and procedures that were put into effect after World War II in an effort to restabilize Europe.
I think we're not far off. I believe you're
right, Brian. Yeah.
Yeah.
Here's a question for Phil that I've never heard anybody on his side answer or respond or tell me what they mean. What does "Make America Great Again" mean?
I think
what period in time do you want to go back to?
Thank you.
Where's again? I think is what the question is.
I could say that for me it was the.
We're not talking about you. We're talking about
I think that's where that statement goes. Is it goes to every individual that wants the same feeling that they had.
Then everybody isn't going to be satisfied because everybody has a different definition.
Well, it may be that, but I think it's more. It goes back to a more base feeling or base emotion than.
Okay, when was America great?
That time period.
When was America great?
When was that period for you?
It was probably when Reagan was president.
Oh really? Where more people in the administration were sent to prison than any other administration in history?
Well, I thought that more of them went to prison.
And what was the tax rate back then?
When we had a guy who
It's not a thing about facts and time and this.
No, it's not about facts.
Day.
I want to go back to
check. You're not listening.
I know I'm not listening.
We're listening.
So for you, it's just a nostalgia thing.
It's a nostalgia thing. For me, yeah. I want to go back to James Garfield.
All right. Well, you
he was our last truly. He was our last truly great president because you can't tell me a single thing he did, which means he didn't do anything wrong.
Alex, you voted for him, didn't you?
Yes, I did.
Yeah. We should go back to William Henry Harrison.
Actually, I went.
I'll tell you what I think it means. I think it means a time when we had less colored people.
I think so too. I think that's what it means.
Or when they in the 50s.
Because otherwise, why can't people stumble around, Phil, with no answer?
Okay. I think that.
Wait a minute. Brian is trying to say some
charged statement that has nothing to do with reality.
I don't think it's racist charged. I think that "Make America Great Again"
Mark's statement about colored people.
That's what I was about to say. I think that "Make America Great Again" is shorthand for "let's get rid of the blacks."
That's what he's saying.
No, I thought it was shorthand for "let's get rid of Alex Bennett." But you know, the thing is,
was that a joke? Asked, let me write that down. I want to be able to repeat it myself.
Put it on your pad.
Yeah.
Why can't you say what it means, Phil?
I told you what it means. I told you it's an emotional thing. It isn't a matter of this time period from 1962 to 1967.
But it is a slogan that is supposed to refer to something. Let's make America great again, meaning that a certain finite point in history, it stopped being great.
That's your interpretation. I was asked my interpretation, and I'm telling you that it's strictly an emotional statement to create emotion, and it has nothing to do with a particular period or even a reality. It's just a strictly emotional statement.
Jason will know what I'm talking about here. When I was a kid, I was born in Detroit, Jason, near Grand River in Wyoming, just south of the Jeffries. When my folks moved to Dearborn when I was a kid, we had the most racist mayor in the North, a guy named Orville Hubbard, and his slogan was "Keep the niggers out."
I didn't vote for him.
And then you couldn't say that anymore, so the slogan became "Keep Dearborn clean."
But Phil, you spread some propaganda videos showing all of these Arabs in Dearborn, which is more of
they weren't in Dearborn; they were in Saudi Arabia.
No, there were some that was in Dearborn that you sent a video on Facebook Messenger.
Yeah.
And showing how there's no American flags on any of these houses and, you know, everything is in Arab writing on the signs, but they also had an English writing underneath it. But those are specialized neighborhoods. You know, it's a neighborhood in Dearborn.
And then
I don't know if you ever watched the video I sent you back about Dearborn. Actuality of Dearborn.
By the way, Jeff, at any point during this discussion, since you haven't been saying anything for a little while, have you wanted to cough and go, bullshit?
Yeah, I'm a little, I want to say disappointed in some of the discussion. Particularly Phil's lack of a real an answer to what... Yeah. He thinks it's so important.
Jeff, Jeff, I told you, as far as I'm concerned, it doesn't relate to a time period. It relates to an emotional
what you're admitting then, Phil, is that it's jingoistic.
Yes.
Oh, well, that's exactly terrible. What it is. That's terrible. All this is jingoism. That's all it is.
That's what do you think most elections are?
I think, in most cases, some of the worst elections that we've had have been about issues. Jason?
I say for my ancestors, the saying of make America great again would be taking it back before 1492.
Yeah, well, you see, everybody is trying. You just don't like the fact that I called a spade, and
oh
I said, that,
oh, "Okay, oh, all right." It is.
Well, I could have called it a club or a heart, but it has nothing to do with a particular time period. You're trying to nail it down to some sort of
Phil,
time period.
You were asked a question. You were asked a question,
and I answered.
Make America great again. When do we go? How far back do we have to go? Here's a better question. When did we stop being great?
We never stopped being great.
Oh,
but
we don't have to be great again, right?
Right, because you see that some people feel that the way the country was headed prior to Trump was not in the right direction.
Phil, I want to bite my arm off. Okay,
it was in the right direction when Clinton ran. When Bill Clinton was in office,
probably
wasn't so bad because he was white.
Yeah. Yes, Diane has her hand up. Diane has her hand up. Diane has her hand up.
I disagree completely.
And for a white guy, you keep pulling you and Jeff and especially Mark pull the colored card.
Oh, I did too. I did too. I did too. Yeah. You know why we pulled the colored card? Wait a minute, hold on a second. You know why we pulled the colored card? You know why we pulled it? Is because it's true. Okay.
Delusional.
Let other people talk. Rob?
Think about this. We've got this rise in hate crimes. We've got this rise we've got people who are just horrible people who are racist who support Donald Trump. He is enabling, whether he wants to or not, he's enabling them. How does that happen?
Hey, you know what? You had people that were unhappy with the current administration, whether it was that he was black or that he was a socialist.
Mostly because he was black, not because he was a socialist.
Wasn't a socialist.
He wasn't a socialist.
What was Obama's approval rating when he left office?
I think it was in the 60s, wasn't it? Where is Trump's?
Low 30s.
Diane, you've had your hand up here.
And I can't believe I'm going to say that I'm trying to stick up for Phil in that trying to say is that what they're trying to, Trump and all them are trying to appeal to is the good old days.
Right.
The idea of the good old days. And it is. It's an emotional appeal. I'm not saying it's right. I'm just saying that's what it is. What he's trying to do, and everybody wants the good old days.
Well, I would like
and
to
the
know.
Good old days were never really that as good as people like.
There's no good old day, but everybody thinks that what was before was better because today is tough.
Jack Bishop,
just make the slogan "Make America Great"?
Jack, if you're trying to call us, hold on a second. Jack Bishop is trying to call us. If you can listen to me, if you can hear me, don't call because we have a full house and we can't take another person. I wish there was some way I could do a cutoff point, you know, and not have to have people call in. Or
have you ever tried doing more than 10 since the recent upgrades?
No, if you do more than 10, it'll work. I can go up to 25, but it's all audio.
But have you tried that since there's been other
upgrades? Yeah. No, I know that it only goes up that high. And, you know, we're pushing it at 9, all right? So, you know, because you had trouble getting your thing on.
Yeah, if Brian had a camera, there'd be one guy without camera.
Yeah. So we'll all have to call into Jack's show and see what he's trying to say.
Yeah, but we're not off here yet.
Well, just saying.
I think we do? We always tend to think about the good old days. The fact is that I can think and I can remember in most of the decades I've lived in, and I think you've lived in some of the most of those decades too, Jeff, and I think to a lesser extent, Phil and Mark, that every decade I've lived in has had its share of problems, whether it was the war in Vietnam or when I was back in the 50s growing up, it was the McCarthy era. You know, it was the House subcommittee hearings, this kind of witch hunting that was going on in this country. So that wasn't very pretty. And then we got into the Vietnam War in the 60s. And then in the 70s, I can't remember what it was. I can't remember what it was because I was so high in drugs for that that decade that I don't remember what was going on. But, you know.
Well, that's what was good.
The 80s was Jordache Jeets.
That's when it was great.
Jordache. Yes, Mark.
And one thing that maybe is the answer is when I was a kid in Dearborn, my neighborhood, all the moms were home during the day. The dads worked, the moms were home.
Yeah.
The guys could go to work and get a blue-collar job and be able to support a family. And they could work there their entire life till they retired.
That's right.
Today, there's insecurity amongst those people.
Well, I'll tell you, and Jason has his hand up, but let me address that first. The problem that we do have is that with all this damn equality that has come about between men and women, men can go out and get a job, and women can go out and get a job. Before, one person went to work, and the other one stayed at home and raised the kids. And so, therefore, your workforce was far... the jobs available to people were far more and more available, and it was actually a worker's workplace because they could make some of the deals themselves. You get what I'm saying?
Yeah.
But as we've gotten this whole thing where women now go to work too, you've got like two people in the family going to work and taking the job of two people, where before one person would have gotten a job and the other one would have stayed at home. So that's how the workplace has changed, and that's also why the unemployment rate has gone up and so on. If we had the same ethos that we had back then of just, you know, the guy goes to work and the woman stays at home and takes care of the kids, we would not have the massive unemployment we have right now.
We have a lot of veterans coming back from Iraq and Iran that, you know, need jobs, and they were out of the workforce for a while.
Yeah, but what I'm saying is, but you're completely avoiding what I was saying, is that we have created a workforce now in which both people in the family are kind of expected to go to work. Jason?
I was just curious that when you're saying something about working at one job, you know, their whole life, I just wonder if we go around and say, how long is the longest you've ever worked at a single job? I think Phil might have the longest, but.
But Alex has been in the same kind of job for the.
Not same job, though.
Same employer.
Same employer. Well, I'm self-employed. Nobody else would hire me.
Okay, so how many years have you been, Phil?
Since I worked for my dad, probably 1970.
Yeah, but you're self-employed, and so that's an entirely different situation. How about you, Kevin? What's the longest job you've ever held down?
I've had four jobs since I was out of high school. One was 13. I had a five-year, about 11 year, and the last one was 18.
Yeah.
It adds up to about 41, I think.
How about you, Brian?
Okay. Being a millennial, technically, I have the longest job I had was more recent. It was part-time, though. Five years, roughly, as a school bus driver. But I've had, other than that, I've had, like, maybe 12 to 14 jobs since my sophomore year of high school.
Yeah.
Back in 1998-1999.
Mark, what was the longest job you ever had?
I've been self-employed for like 30 years, so.
Okay. Mark with a
suit. I mean the regular working class person, now their life is different than when I was younger.
Yeah. Mark with a C?
Staff jobs, a couple of them 7 years apiece.
Okay. How about you, Jeff?
About 40 years for myself.
You're self-employed then?
I was.
Yeah. Diane?
Well, I've been in healthcare for 22 years. But
I'm talking about a singular job.
Singular job, 7 years.
7 years. How about you, Rob?
About 5 years.
Five years? Ever. Yeah. Yeah, okay. Me, I think it's I think it had to be San Francisco, and I think it had to be Live 105, although I got fired and went away for 9 months and came back. So I don't know if that constitutes two job periods. If I count that as one whole period, two.
Oh, wait a minute. Didn't when you got fired, weren't they paying you not to work?
No, that was the second time around.
Oh.
So you're saying, Mark, I should count that as two jobs? Because if I count that as one job, it's like 11 years. But the most then would have to be SiriusXM, which was 9.5, something like that. So
you see, and that's what Brian says about his job history. Mm-hmm. My final last 12, 13 years, I was management. And I hired and fired people. And I hired people when I would have people come in for jobs. The typical history of anybody nowadays was about 5 to 6 years. And you would, you know, typically you look at an application and you would see, you know, 2, 3, 4 jobs. I was at, you know, IBM for 20 years or whatever. But as I started doing the hiring, I could see these applications would come in. The first thing I would look for is how many jobs has he had in how much time? Mm-hmm. And it was very typical to see about five-year average.
Wow.
People hop around. There was no loyalty to the company.
Right.
And
I don't know if maybe the
company I worked for, we had people that were there since they got out of high school, and they were probably there 41, 45 years.
Was that a union job?
No, it wasn't.
Oh, I was going to say, because I think that's what maybe the difference with me is, you know, I'm only 36 and I've been with the same company for 17 years.
Wow. Yeah,
and that's maybe that's because it's a union job.
Action.
That's the union
action.
I actually worked with a very large public relations firm back in the late 90s, and I became very close, sort of, I guess, in a way, mm-hmm. with one of the owners of this public relations firm, a woman who prided herself on HR. You could bring your pets to work. It was all this wonderful.
Yeah.
And they was on the West Coast.
California.
And I was in the IT department, and we purchased that company. And we absorbed that company, and the woman who ran it became a vice president of that company, and she stayed for a couple of years, and then obviously she got her parachute and she was gone. But one day I had a discussion with her, and she said she about the IT guy that she had with her, who was loyal to her for about 9 years. He took her all the way through with different technologies and made her successful. And in the end, she looked at me and said, "He's lazy." And I said, "Well, what do you mean he's lazy?" And she said, "He's been here 9 years. He should be off doing other things. There's no reason why anybody should be in a job for 9 years." And that's exactly the way they think nowadays. There's no more that they want you to last for 25 years and get the gold watch and retire. And
gets the gold watch anymore. Are you kidding me?
They throw all that shit out because they don't need it.
Yeah.
All they do,
they don't wear watches anymore.
They look
loyalty
at you.
Loyalty goes both ways.
Yeah, I mean, they look at you
and
they
say, true.
You're lazy. You're lazy, you're comfortable with your position, and you don't want to leave.
What are you saying, Phil?
All the guys that were cops that I did my 20 years with that were regulars, mm-hmm. they are living the life of Riley right now. I made a big mistake. I should have been a regular cop. I would have been in my 50s, and I would have been thinking about where I want to take my next vacation next week.
Yeah.
Boy, your fan is noisy, Diane, but it's almost the end of the show now.
Brian, don't get me wrong. I'm not putting you down for your job history, but I'm just using that as a comparison.
Okay. I know.
Of what I see, you know.
Yeah. It might be Brian. Brian, I think you have your car on again, don't you?
No, I don't. I have it off.
Really?
Yeah.
It's always fun when you have 9 people trying to figure out where the noise is coming from.
Oh, you only have 2 minutes to go, and Bob Rubin's thing's up to $2,535.
It was earlier, too. So
yeah,
yeah. Anyway, hey, listen. You're
talking about having all of them on together as a group.
Yeah,
all the old comedians. That'd be awesome.
Yeah,
yeah. I agree.
Have to see if I can arrange that. Hey, listen, this has been a lot of fun tonight, Kevin. Thank you once again, Jason. Thank you once again, Phil Meyer. Thank you as always, Brian. Thank you, Mark. Wonderful seeing you here. Love to see your face every now and then, Jeff Stein. You know we love the world out of you. Diane Weeks, great seeing you here tonight to add something feminine to the group. Rob Alfano, wonderful seeing you in that empty room. And Mark Green, thank you so much. I appreciate it.
I muted my mic.
It wasn't you. Who knows what it was? I give up trying to ever figure it out. Anyway, I want to thank all of you for being here. And we'll see you again. We'll see you again next week. Bye-bye. Anyway, that's it for our little program tonight, and hope you've enjoyed it in both versions, the audio version with video and the video version with the citizens panel. I'll see you again next, let's see here, it's going to be on Tuesday, and in the meantime, The Intersection is next with Jack and Amy, followed by Connections. See you Tuesday, same time, same station in life. In the meantime, if you see her, you know what to do. Tell her I love her, okay?